in high definition, where news comes first. This is WECT's Carolina in the Morning.
Because it's like an earthquake. A lot of the buildings are gone. We need to get some search teams in here to get the people out.
Massive explosions and fire at a Texas fertilizer plant, killing at least, they're saying now, between 5 and 15 people, also sending hundreds to the hospital.
Well, today officials in the port city will try to show you the effects of bullying in schools.
Anger this morning from the White House and Newtown families after the Senate fails to pass stricter gun control measures.
Good morning, everybody. This morning, we're continuing to follow the breaking news story coming out of West Texas, a town near Waco. The massive explosion overnight or yesterday afternoon at the fertilizer plant there has taken between 5 and 15 lives and injured some 160 people. That's the numbers we've received so far. Officials saying, though, a lot have been injured, houses destroyed, the numbers coming in all morning long. The plant located some 80 miles away from Dallas. At this time, we know the fire is contained. There are some talks, though, of hazardous gas in the area. Medical response units from all over the state of Texas are heading there trying to help out.
There was just a major explosion. The windows came in on me, the roof came in on me, the ceiling came in. I worked my way out to go get some more help.
Of course, we're following this breaking news story out of the Texas area there, this massive explosion, and bring you the latest details as soon as they come in. Those figures and information still coming in all morning long.
And what we've heard a lot this morning is the blast itself is being compared to an earthquake because there was seismic activity, which, Colin, I guess is basically the force of it. It was that forceful?
Yeah, nearby Richter scales were actually able to move. The gauges moved just due to the explosion itself. That's the least of the concerns, though. Now we turn our focus to what's happening just to the west of West Texas there, to the north of Waco. You notice this line of strong showers and thunderstorms pushing in. We're talking about straight line wind gusts of 35, maybe 40 miles per hour in listening in on some of the official press conferences there. It looks like that they are well aware of the weather situation and appropriate action has been taken. But you can see here a squall line using our interactive digital Doppler tools moving that direction, probably here within the next 30 minutes to an hour. That'll moving up toward the Waco area, then again off toward west here within the next 45 minutes or so. That's one of the stories that we'll be covering throughout the morning, is how this line will impact locations in North Texas. Why do I mention it so much? This same line will be working its way toward us as we move through the middle of Friday afternoon into Saturday. That's the cold front that's going to change things up for us. We're talking about highs back into the 60s. We'll talk more about that, show you the 7-day forecast as well, and the latest model information coming up during my complete First Alert forecast in about 6 minutes.
Colin, thanks. Happening tonight, a free screening of the documentary Bully. Now it's an effort to bring awareness to the issue of bullying in schools. Emma Castro, that is, a Pender County freshman, speaking out, claiming that it's a much larger problem than a lot of people realize. She started getting threatening messages 3 years ago. This year, it got worse. Despite reporting it to the school resource officer, she says many of her friends, like her, don't know what else to do. She's urging them to speak out and tell someone so bullying can come to an end.
So yesterday, our own Michelle Lee had the chance to talk to city leaders, school leaders, and students in a Google Plus Hangout, and they told us what parents are not seeing. They even mentioned how they investigate reports. The police chief said he sees bullying in gang culture, but the bottom line was that kids need parents and teachers to help because they're often too afraid to come forward and tell anyone just how bad the bullying is.
Yeah, today I found out that my cousin was being cyberbullied by two other students in school, and he kind of tried to just wipe it off, but then he just retaliated.
I think our students here were just saying that this kid wanted to fight and wanted to retaliate. Everyone has a breaking point, and somehow we've got to be able to get to them before we get to the breaking points.
That's exactly why we've teamed up with the police department to show a free screening of the documentary Bully tonight. It takes place at 7 at Thalian Hall. The event is free, although we did ask you to get tickets, and we're told that the screening may be sold out. In any case, additional information can be found on our website, WECT.com.
Well, in Columbus County today, people living in a part of Whiteville are looking for ways to stay safe after a recent string of shootings there. And this meeting taking place tonight with residents of the Running Meade, High Woods, and Baldwin Woods community going to a safety meeting talking about crimes in the area. They say the increase in crime is because county officials have a probation office located nearby, and they plan to ask the county to move that probation office elsewhere. Law enforcement expected to be there as well tonight to hear all of their concerns.
New this morning, the North Carolina House Elections Committee has endorsed a bill requiring voters to show a photo ID at the polls. Voter ID has emerged as a contentious issue nationally and also on the state level. That bill now goes to the House Finance Committee. It's then expected to reach the House floor, possibly next Wednesday or Thursday.
And looking ahead, a judge in the murder trial of Mario McNeil saying the opening statement should begin Monday in Cumberland County. The jury was seated yesterday at McNeil's trial, who's accused of buying, raping, and killing a 5-year-old girl, Shania Davis, of Fayetteville in 2009. McNeil could face the death penalty if convicted. Meanwhile, Davis's mother also facing charges in the case, accused of selling the little girl to pay off a drug debt. Town leaders in Leland will be talking about making a smoke-free campus, so they're meeting tonight. Cafier Community College, that you're looking at now, also has one. It means smoking would be banned on the property that the town owns. And if people want to take a smoke break, they'll have to leave town property to light up. The mayor of Leland saying there's no written rules when it comes to smoking on town property.
Later tonight, the State Department of Transportation will hold a public meeting to talk about the temporary closure of 3rd Street in Wilmington. The NCDOT plans to close 3rd Street in the fall of next year to repair a pipe used for overflow from Greenfield Lake. The pipe is under 3rd Street in South Front. This means a detour for drivers during that road closure. So citizens are encouraged to attend tonight's meeting to speak individually with DOT officials, and that meeting is taking place from 5 to 7 tonight at Thalian Hall. Well, there is shock and anger in Washington this morning after the Senate killed a bill that would have expanded background checks to gun shows and also internet sales.
Even with 4 Republicans crossing party lines to support it, the compromise between the Democrats and Republicans failed. Tracy Potts on Capitol Hill this morning with reaction and what is next.
So all in all, this was a pretty shameful day for Washington.
President Obama claims the National Rifle Association lied about the compromise.
The amendment is not agreed to.
It fell 6 votes short of passing. 5 Democrats voted against it. Supporters blame conservatives choosing their battles.
They're saying, well, maybe the immigration and maybe guns on top of that might be too much for me to go home and explain.
Later this morning, we'll hear from former Congresswoman Gabby Gifford. She lobbied for the bill. In a scathing op-ed in the New York Times, she calls lawmakers cowards, ignoring tearful pleas from Newtown families.
We will not be defeated. We are not defeated, and we will not be defeated. We are not going away.
The hardest part was to try to look these families in the eye and explain to them how 90% of the American people can be on their side and the United States Senate failed to reach 60 votes.
But the National Rifle Association, which lobbied heavily against expanding background checks, thanked lawmakers, defeating what it calls a misguided effort that would have criminalized some private transfers.
What that bill does is targets law-abiding citizens.
Change Washington. You, the American people, are going to have to sustain some passion about this.
This morning, they're promising to do just that.
In fact, sponsor Joe Manchin says he's already talking to his colleagues about how to tweak this bill to get it passed. Tracy Potts, NBC News, Washington.
Major legislation there in contention in Washington. Parts of the nation, central parts of the nation, having some pretty nasty weather yesterday.
Exactly, and I guess it's kind of a precursor to what we are going to see, but hopefully not this bad there,
Colin.
Yeah,
this stuff heading toward us. Take a look at this. This is a video from Illinois. Green, Illinois, are frantically filling up sandbags, preparing for possible flooding. Officials there say that by late Friday, the DePlain River could crest as high as 3.5 feet over flood level. The river has been spilling over the banks and rising at a steady pace. National Weather Service has issued a flood warning for Lake County, Illinois, for the next 7 days in anticipation of the system that's moving toward us. Switch over, I'll show you exactly what we're talking about. Look at this line of showers. All of this will be filling up the tributaries here, North Mississippi River, in through the Missouri River Valley. A slow-moving system. This will take until Friday midday or late Friday before we really see any effects of this over eastern North Carolina, but that's what we'll be watching and monitoring. Of course, this morning we're watching your ride to the bus stop. Patchy fog possible out there. Not a whole lot of issues in regards to the fog. We've seen some high clouds overhead. That actually helps to inhibit the fog from developing, so we're not having too many issues with that. And again, another afternoon here with just about perfect conditions. You really don't get much better than this. Sun and clouds, need the sunglasses, maybe the chapstick. It remains a little bit dry. Daytime high temperatures tomorrow are going to be a little nicer, well, a little warmer, I should say, with more humidity. We'll talk about that in just a second. 3 miles of visibility at Fayetteville. That's really the only low spot. Of course, you can always see fog in those locations where we typically see it, but it's not widespread. I don't anticipate any dense fog advisories or prolonged issues this morning as you head to work. Southeasterly winds at 12 miles per hour will help to keep temperatures a little cooler, that plus that cloud cover as well. Take a look at the hour-by-hour temperature forecast. 75 degrees or so for the middle of the afternoon today. Warmer inland. Here comes the cold front back off from the west. You can see it clearly here, these deep blues and greens as they start to move into Asheville and Greenville as we move through Friday afternoon. Late Friday night, here's the line of showers. When it comes in, it'll bring temperatures back down to the 60s, 50s, and 40s. We'll even see some 40s for the start of the day on your Sundays. So some big changes on the way. We'll talk more about that in just a second. But first, I see the Carolines here to get us an update with First Alert Traffic.
That's right, Colin. Well, right now there are no issues on the roads, no accidents. So we're about to head out. You should have no problems at all. So let's take a closer look here at Military Cutoff and Allen's Lane. This intersection is open for you. This is heading towards Eastwood Road. Now, like Colin said, you could run into some patchy fog. You see a little bit of a haze of low lane clouds, but it's not a major issue here. But if you do, just put on those low beams this morning and just be super cautious as you head to work. But we do want to remind you to mark your calendars for next week if you're heading towards Wrightsville Beach. The Wrightsville Beach drawbridge will be closed to drivers overnight next Tuesday from 11:30 p.m. to 5 a.m. Now, officers will be on each end of the bridge there. This is part of the rehabilitation project, so please be cautious if you're heading that way and expect delays for that overnight closure on Tuesday night starting at 11:30. And that's a look at your First Alert Traffic.
Well, if you want to get off the beach and get on the water, just build your own boat. As it turns out, it's not that easy, but it's what CFCC students are doing. And this weekend, they get to show off all their handiwork. We'll have the details after the break.
First Alert Traffic is sponsored by the Law Offices of Richard Flexner. Serious accident or injury? Get Flexner. We're serious. Now, with the WECT mobile app, you'll never be without WECT news. From WECT.com to text and email alerts for breaking news and weather, WECT news. It's all right here in the palm of your hand. Sponsored by your Honda dealers of the Carolinas.
Welcome back to Carolina in the Morning. 6:15 is your time right now. Look at that beautiful sunrise, a luxury of living here in southeastern North Carolina. We see those a lot here on this shift. Now, if you love boats and you want to head to the Cape Fear River, you'll be happy to know that the annual CFCC Boat Show is happening this weekend.
But those boats are very unique. Cape Fear Community College students build them with their own hands. Carolina the Morning's Lindsay Curtin is live this morning from the boat building workshop along the river, telling us what it takes to put a nice boat like that together. Beautiful boats, Lindsay.
Yes, Bob and Kim, from the ground up, students build these boats, and as it turns out, these skills really transfer into great jobs in the job world, and this is how it all starts, is this half model right here. They have to build this, and then I'm here with Mark Bain, the instructor of the boat program, the wooden boat program, and I wanted to ask you, what comes after this?
After the half model, they would loft the plans to the boat life-size on the floor, so it's like life-size marine drafting. So that's the plans for the Carolina Spritzel Sharpie. It's a 20-foot long sailboat, traditional to North Carolina. And they build the frames for that up in the loft floor. That's where we do that, so everything is out of the way. And
it's right there with the ladder. They literally stand up there and plan it life-size.
And crawl around on the loft floor for a couple of weeks, loft the boat, build all the framework. Then we come back down to the floor here, and we set the framework up, and at this point, of course, the boat's right side up. We set the framework up upside down, we build the hulls upside down, and then we roll them right side up to do the finish work, interior seating,
rigging. How long does it take to do all that?
They started building the boats in November, and they'll be sailing them in July.
Wow, do they get to keep the boats?
They're available for sale.
Wow, that's so great. And I mean, this program, like you said earlier, translates into a lot of, you know, real world positions. What do you think is the biggest challenge for students that you see in this program?
Really, if they are not familiar with tools yet, we have to get them comfortable with tools, learn about the safety and maintenance of the tools, right, which is the first couple months of the class. Mm-hmm. Then we get in heavily into the boat building.
And that's what's really incredible. We were talking about this off camera, is that you could come in here, be, not know anything about tools like myself, and then you can end up building a boat.
That's correct.
Pretty incredible. And this event is happening this weekend, this Saturday, 9:30 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. The students are going to show off all their handiwork. There will also be some other boats that you can visit as well. See as well. Thousands of people expected to come in town. We're going to be live here a little bit later. We're actually going to take it to the second part of the process.
That's correct.
What are we going to be learning about there?
Spray painting, electrical work. That's the boat manufacturer and service program.
Perfect, where they put on the finishing touches. Thank you, Mark. Appreciate it. We're going to be live here a little bit later, but we're going to send it back to you in the studio.
This morning, we're learning that Carnival Cruise Line says it will spend millions of dollars to improve its ability to respond to emergencies. Carnival, which had three ships suffer various problems in recent months, says it will enhance emergency power capabilities and introduce new fire safety technology. The cruise line also says it will improve the level of operating redundancies across its entire fleet of 24 ships. They plan to spend around $300 million.
Always nice to go down to the Caribbean, but why leave when you can have nice weather like we're
exactly
having right here, right now?
That's what's up. You know, you look outside right now, who needs the Caribbean? You got Wrightsville Beach on a day like this, WBLivesurf.com, their live stream there. Looks like, there we go, frozen up a little bit. You can see a decent swell again this morning, not nearly the same surf that we saw yesterday afternoon in the noon show. Kim and I watched a guy ride, seriously, like a 15, almost 20 second wave. Amazing waves out there. That has subsided. Some folks out enjoying, though, the beach this morning. Let's take a look at the beach and boat forecast. We'll start off with a look down at the Cape Fear boat building program there on the banks of the Cape Fear River. The Cape Hatteras, their research vessel there in the foreground, the background, the PPD building, perfectly calm conditions along the waterways here in eastern North Carolina. Temperature, water temperature, 64 degrees at Wrightsville Beach, 72 degrees at the 5 Mile Buoy. We're going to see some changes in the winds here as they'll be steaming out of the south and southeast at 10 to 15 miles per hour. But watch what happens as we go into late Friday out of the south at 20 miles per hour. This is going to be funneling in a lot of heat and humidity. Whoosh, there comes the cold front winds out of the north as we go into Saturday morning. Some big changes on the way, some cooler conditions expected for the remainder of the weekend. Once we get into Saturday afternoon, we'll only get up into the 60s Sunday as well. There's your tide times. Low tide coming up here at about 8 or 8:25, depending upon whether you're at the Lockwood Follies Inlet there or over at Masonboro Inlet from the south to the east. High tide then at 2:30 this afternoon. Daytime high temperatures will continue to run into the upper 70s or low 80s for the next couple of days, but there's those changes. Comes with showers and thunderstorms on Saturday. Bob and Kim.
Colin, I didn't know that you and Kim watching me surf at Wrightsville Beach yesterday during the noon show.
You look good, dude.
We
caught
you.
Yeah. I was on the water, but certainly not surfing yesterday doing that. All right. Well, this morning, the Internal Revenue Service is offering a helping hand for the taxpayers affected by the Boston Marathon tragedy. The IRS has announced a three-month filing and payment extension. Automatic extensions will be applied to all people who live in Suffolk County, Massachusetts, including in the city of Boston. It also takes into consideration those who live outside of the area, including victims, their families, first responders, even taxpayers whose tax preparers were impacted by the events on Monday. Those living outside of the area will need to call the Internal Revenue Service starting Tuesday of next week to notify them.
Also in the wake of the Boston tragedy, Homeland Security wants you to know how to be aware of some travel security measures. Now, at this time, no national alerts have been issued, according to the Department of Homeland Security website. However, as a precautionary measure, you'll see enhanced security measures at all major transportation hubs and airports. So for now, you'll want to make sure you allow extra travel time for your travels.
And if you're looking for a better way to manage your money, you might consider a prepaid debit card. With one of the prepaid cards, there's no credit check and no minimum balance required. New report showing there's been a 600% increase in the prepaid card usage in the past 3 years. The trend seems to be gaining steam, though, among banks. That's some good news for consumers. Many financial institutions now have lower fees for the prepaid cards. However, analysts say to watch out for some of the gotcha fees. That may include an activation fee or a declined transaction charge.
Of course, more Carolina in the morning to come. First, though, here's a look at what's for lunch at school today. Remember, if you miss one of these menus, you can always go to our website, WECT.com, then go to the Carolina in the Morning page, and we'll connect you to your school from there.
Welcome back to Carolina in the Morning today on this Thursday morning. Right now, we're at 24 minutes after the hour as we are looking at downtown Wilmington right now from the battleship North Carolina. High on one of the masts there on the battleship's nice day ahead. Collins forecast coming up in just a couple of minutes. News from overseas right now, though. This morning, we're learning that Beijing's first confirmed bird flu case, a 7-year-old girl, has left the hospital. Doctors say they successfully treated her. The infection was the first case to be reported outside of the region in the eastern part of China, where the new bird flu strain first emerged there last month. The World Health Organization saying the new strain has so far killed 16 people, but despite the threat, authorities say there's still no signs of human-to-human transmission.
And this morning, all 97 crew members on board a fishing vessel have been rescued after a fire broke out on board while the ship was operating in Antarctic waters. The crew abandoned the burning ship more than 30 miles from a Chilean research base on the northern tip of the Antarctic Peninsula. A ship is expected to arrive at the base to ferry the crew away.
Back in our state, Charlotte leaders will be meeting today to discuss how to fund some upgrades at the Bank of America Stadium. A bill passed in the legislature recently would only allow the Queen City to use existing tax money to pay for the upgrades. City officials in Charlotte now trying to put together a new deal to offer to the Carolina Panthers of the NFL, hoping to keep the town from leaving Charlotte and going somewhere else. Hopefully that will not be happening.
I hope not. All right, 26 after 6 o'clock, and we're checking in with Colin
again. Related sports news, you know, I wanted to show you guys this and kind of gauge your reaction. I saw this on YouTube. This is actually put up by our assignment manager, but just take a look and listen. The Buffalo Sabres and the Boston Bruins game was canceled during the Boston Marathon explosion. This is them coming back last night.
Honor Guard to present tonight's colors.
An amazing moment. Watch this.
Say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly
puts the mic down? Think, guys.
I love it. I wish I could sing. I would start singing it
myself.
That's
kind of make you want to just join in with the 20,000 folks there at the Bruins game. An amazing moment. Thought we'd share that with you guys. Just
City of Boston down but not out right now, certainly.
You bet. Fantastic way that that city has responded in the light of tragedy. Of course, we continue to await developments there, but we'll post this on our Facebook page for you as well. As we take a look at the forecast for today, perhaps traveling across the United States, mild conditions, no delays out of the eastern terminals here. New York looking good, Boston as well, Philadelphia at 54 degrees, Chicago at 46 and 53 in Dallas. Looking good for us today. We'll see those daytime high temperatures getting back up to about 78 degrees. A gorgeous day here in southeastern North Carolina. Before we head to break, take a look at the fishing game forecast for today. Looks like the best time to get out and try some fishing. 8:40 this morning and 8:20 this afternoon. More coming up after this.
And of course, another tragedy. We're continuing to watch the latest developments in a explosion and fire in Texas. The death toll now between 5 and 15. We'll bring the latest details when we come back to Carolina in the Morning. A look now at some of the top stories we've been following this morning.
All that whole street is gone.
massive explosion and fire at a fertilizer plant in Texas, killing at least 5 to 15 and injuring hundreds more. The fire is contained right now, but rescue efforts continue.
President Obama is scheduled to take the trip up to Boston today to pay tribute to the victims of the Boston Marathon bomb attacks. Plus, we have more shedding more light on some of the misinformation that's circulating around the area.
This morning, the White House is expressing anger after the Senate fails to pass stricter gun control measures. It fell 6 votes short of passing. 5 Democrats voted against it. There are already talks of tweaking the bill to try to get it passed again.
As we take a look at the forecast, temperatures today moving up to 76, maybe 77 degrees over in coastal locations of southeastern North Carolina. Did you like yesterday? Today is going to be very similar with high pressure in control across all of eastern North Carolina. Broad view shows that there are a lot of showers and thunderstorms moving into the Red River, at least the eastern Red River Valley, then back toward the Mississippi River Valley. In fact, of course, our top story that Kim and Bob just mentioned, that explosion in West Texas, just north of Waco. Just to add insult to injury, strong thunderstorms with heavy straight line winds and rain expected to start to move across the I-35 town. Of course, those officials there said that they are prepared for the switch of the winds and the strong straight line winds and heavy downpours. That's happening now. For the latest on updates there, Bob and Kim.
Yes, Colin, the biggest story of the morning, that fertilizer plant explosion in Texas. Let's right now take a look at exactly where the plant is. You're seeing a Google map version layout of the location of this fertilizer plant. The blast happened at the West Fertilizer Company plant in the town of West Texas, which is about 80 miles south of Dallas.
And right now, multiple videos are coming out of the explosion or showing the explosion. The scene right after that major explosion happened, it was already on fire. Some reports are saying anywhere, as Kim mentioned, between 5 and 15 people confirmed dead, at least 160 others injured. Some of the firefighters are still unaccounted for from a volunteer fire department. Firefighters were already at the plant battling the fire when, you'll see in just a moment here, the explosion occurred. That blast so strong, many in the area thought that it was actually an earthquake happening.
This is some video of livestock and debris in the area right after the explosion. Nearly 175 other buildings, including a middle school and nursing home, were damaged by the explosion. So many were injured, deputies used their squad cars as ambulances to take injured people to area hospitals.
Authorities have already set up a triage area now at the local high school football field trying to treat the injured. However, it was quickly evacuated because officials were concerned about a second major explosion.
Officials are saying it will be some time before they know how many people have been killed in the explosion. Officials speculating that more than 100 people have been injured.
And the explosion sent the flames shooting high into the night sky there in West Texas, raining burning ember, shrapnel, and debris down. It also leveled buildings blocks in every direction. A city council member saying a 4-block area around the explosion is, quote, totally decimated. Be sure to stay with us throughout the morning here on Carolina The Morning. We'll bring you the latest details from Texas right here on the program as soon as they come in.
And of course, continuing to cover the Boston Marathon explosions as well this morning. President Obama and the First Lady will be traveling to Boston today to pay tribute to the victims in the Boston Marathon bomb attack. And this morning, there could be a major break in the bombing case. A local politician says investigators are looking for a man seen in department store video surveillance dropping off a bag at the site of the bombings. And a law enforcement official says authorities have spotted an image of someone who could be a potential suspect in the bombings, but they haven't identified that person. Massachusetts Governor Deval Patrick says the investigation into Monday's bombings is going to take some time.
Doing this in a very methodical way, very thorough way. It's several blocks over there that they're covering a square inch at a time and piecing the story together and I think making progress.
And this morning, at least 14 people wounded at the Marathon bombings remain in critical condition in hospitals there. Dozens of people have been released from the hospitals. 3 area Boston medical facilities that have been treating the most severely injured patients expect all of them will survive.
And this morning, we're giving you an update on the condition of Nicole Gross and her family. Her family tells us she went through a 3rd surgery yesterday. She's from Charlotte. Her brother-in-law says Nicole has 2 broken legs and a torn Achilles tendon. Her sister lost part of her leg, and her husband suffered burns from the blast.
In the wake of the Monday bombings up at Boston at the Marathon, some people have questioned security at the event. One official saying between city, state, and other law enforcement agencies, there were more than 1,000 officers and soldiers deployed before the explosions. A former Boston police lieutenant saying, given that information that Boston police had before the race, security was more than sufficient. But now more police officers will be out, more special weapons units, and more outside law enforcement agencies will be coming in.
I think you'll see more plainclothes officers in the next running of this marathon for sure. Without question, that will be an emphasis in the next deployment plan will be a heavy presence of plainclothes officers infiltrating the crowd.
And this morning, we want to let you know that there are scams and false reports going around. Here are some of them. There are stories about a Sandy Hook child being killed in the bombing. Another one about a woman killed just before a proposal for marriage. Both of those stories appear to be false. And there was a message retweeted 52,000 times on Twitter claiming it would give money to victims for just passing along the message. That was a lie. Also, watch out for false charities. Remember, for all the latest updates, you can find them on our website, WECT.com.
It is 6:38 right now. New details this morning on the suspect arrested for sending a deadly poison letter to a U.S. senator. The suspect, Paul Kevin Curtis, was arrested yesterday, accused of mailing letters with the deadly poison ricin. This morning, we're learning more about him. According to some reports, he may have uncovered a conspiracy to trade human body parts on the black market, and he sometimes performed as an Elvis Presley impersonator. Well, Curtis is suspected of mailing letters to the president, Mississippi U.S. Senator Roger Wicker, and perhaps even to a district court judge.
The way that the letters were typewritten to those two individuals, the postmark similarities that we had, it raised suspicion that there could possibly be a connection to the letter that we received in justice court.
But additional tests now being done to make sure the substance is indeed the poison ricin.
New this morning, former governor and congressional candidate Mark Sanford says he doesn't know who leaked sealed documents to the press. Those court papers allege that he entered his ex-wife's home 2 months ago to watch the Super Bowl with his son, which violated a divorce settlement. The former governor of South Carolina will now have to go to court to answer those allegations 2 days after May's special congressional election. Jenny Sanford hasn't commented about the issue. Mark Sanford's challenger, Elizabeth Colbert Bush, also wouldn't comment, and now we're learning the National Republican Congressional Committee will not spend any more money on Sanford's May 7th special election.
Back in the Tar Heel State, Kyla's law is now heading to the governor's desk. The full Senate approved the law yesterday. The bill will increase penalties for convicted child abusers. It would actually double the maximum sentence to more than 30 years for child abuse crimes. Kyla Davenport suffered severe brain damage after prosecutors say her stepfather beat her. He, Joshua Hauser, is now behind bars on a $1 million bond and is scheduled to be back in court in June.
Well, North Carolina Governor Pat McCrory is expected to make a major transportation policy announcement this morning. No word on exactly what that is, but the meeting will take place in Raleigh at 9:30, and we will let you know what comes out of that.
All right, a lot of heavy rain in parts of the country around here for us today. Sounds like a pretty nice day, but nasty other areas.
Yeah, it really has been. Take a look at this video. This is from the Midwest. A line of severe thunderstorms rolled through Illinois and Missouri yesterday. This tractor trailer turned over. We heard that there were no injuries with this, but blown over by the wind. Storm also damaging buildings. Reports that wind gusts have reached an excess of 70 miles per hour, peeling away the metal facade there that you can see. It's going to continue to move its way into Indiana today, Ohio, eventually Kentucky, Tennessee, and then here through the Carolinas as we go late Friday into early Saturday. Won't have the severe component. Looks like things are going to wind down a little bit in between now and then. Gorgeous weather here across southeastern North Carolina. We'll get into that in just a second. 76 degrees, what we're anticipating for your daytime high today. Even a little warmer, but we start to draw in that thunderstorm chance mainly late in the period as we go through your Friday. Looks like things will continue to get more moist and more warm as we go through Friday afternoon. 60 degrees out there right now. Pretty good looking morning. Some high clouds. It's really preventing the fog from forming. A wider view shows you that line of thunderstorms. storms back through Missouri into Texas. Of course, at the top of the show, I showed you how that will have its implications on the explosion site just north of Waco between Dallas and Houston. Waco about 50 miles to the south there. So they'll have to contend with what we will also see: scattered showers, some embedded thunderstorms, and gusty conditions late Friday into Saturday. In fact, let's take a look at that on the 7-day forecast. Keep around a 20% chance of precipitation for today, a 40% chance for those showers as we go into Friday. Saturday, a 70% chance of thunderstorms. Of course, that's the day that everybody's watching as we move into the weekend. Looks like we could see conditions continue to at least worsen throughout the day on your Saturday. And then as we go into Sunday, clearer conditions. Notice too here, the forecast, those temperatures, high temperatures expected to reach somewhere in the neighborhood of 68 degrees or so, with the chance for thunderstorms increasing as we go throughout the day on your Friday into Saturday morning. Cooler temperatures through Sunday, but then nice as we head into next week. We'll talk more about the forecast coming up in just a few minutes, but first, Caroline joins us right now with First Alert Traffic.
Thanks, Colin. I'm happy to say that there are no accidents on the roads right now if you're about to start your day this morning. Let's take a closer look here at 3rd and Dawson Street. This is heading towards downtown, or if you're trying to get on the bridge on Wooster or down the bridge on Dawson, you should have no problems here at this time. It's open for you, but again, just be cautious as you head to work or school today. And we do want to remind you that happening today, Cape Fear Public Utility crews will be cleaning sewer lines, causing some closures on North 16th Street between Chestnut and Rankin Streets, and on Gray Street between North 15th and North 17th Streets from 9 this morning until 3 this afternoon. Detours are in place for drivers, but crews ask that you slow down and be cautious throughout the work zone area. And that is a look at your First Alert Traffic.
First Alert Traffic is sponsored by the Law Offices of Richard Flexner. Serious accident or injury? Get Flexner. We're serious. Now, with the WECT mobile app, you'll never be without WECT news. From WECT.com to text and email alerts for breaking news and weather, WECT news, it's all right here in the palm of your hand. Sponsored by Window World of Wilmington, simply the best for less.
Welcome back to Carolina in the Morning. 6:46 is your time, and we're looking at another beautiful sunrise along the Cape Fear River. This is downtown Wilmington. Gorgeous out there. We'll check in with Colin for more on the forecast in just a couple minutes. You know, thousands of people are expected to visit Wilmington this weekend as the annual boat show is taking place.
There is a unique catch. So to this show, Cape Fear Community College students actually built the boats with their own hands. Our Carolina of the Morning's Lindsay Curtin is in the boat building workshop this morning, been telling us what it takes to accomplish a boat like the students made. Lindsay?
Good morning, Bob and Kim. Yeah, such an exciting weekend for our students here at CFCC. They get to show off their handiwork at the boat show this weekend. They built these boats from beginning to end. I'm here with Paul Winchell, an instructor here, and he's actually going to show us the finishing touches to the boat building process. I mean, from beginning to end, the students do it all. What do we need to know about this? I'm wearing a shirt for the boat show. Eat, sleep, sand. What's important about sanding on these?
A lot of people don't realize that sanding is really about 80% of the boat building process. That's why we have it on our official boat show shirt. They're making this boat as fair or smooth as possible. Any sort of imperfections that they leave, if it's any sort of bump or wobble, that'll show up in the finished product and honestly look pretty awful.
Gotcha. And I imagine you get some good arm muscles doing that. Now we're going to walk over to the painting room, but as we walk there, tell me what else happens in this room. They do some electric work?
That's right. We do electrical, plumbing, engine installation, and fiberglass work. Okay. So basically everything that it takes to build a modern vessel, we do over here. And you guys already saw the classic example with the wooden boat building shop next door.
And they're painting in here. It's nice and bright in here. Why is that?
It needs to be nice and bright so that any imperfections that might show up in the paint job will be seen easily. That way you can decide whether you need to just stop painting, continue the fairing process again, or keep going.
I hear this can be kind of frustrating, the painting.
It absolutely is. This is what separates the boys from the men right here. If the paint job doesn't turn out nice, then an owner just isn't going to accept the boat and just isn't going to be yacht quality.
Yeah, and if you see any lumps and bumps or holes, you have to fill it in and sand, resand, and paint over. But, you know, as you can see, they've taken the safety measures and they're wearing their masks there. Now we're going to show you what the finished product looks like over here. And this is a shiny puppy. I can check out my hair on this thing. It's so shiny. How long did it take to put this together, would you say?
This actually didn't take that long. We stripped it just yesterday and repainted it. All in one shot, really.
Wow.
But the normal fairing process can take several months to do. This is just an aluminum boat here. If it was a fiberglass boat that we built, it would have taken a decent amount longer to fair it out.
Wow, I imagine that, like I said, students are going to be very excited to show off their handiwork this weekend. At the end of it all, actually, the students can sell their boats. The money, of course, comes back into the program, and it also goes towards scholarships, but I imagine it's just a very prideful thing to know that someone out there is sailing on your own hand-built boat. Thank you for joining us this morning. If you'd like to figure out the details for this event, head to our website, WECT.com. It's up there for you. I'm going to send it back to you in the studio.
All right, thank you very much. As we take a live look at the First Alert 7-day forecast, you'll notice that those temperatures are going to be rising as we move throughout Thursday into Friday. 40% chance of precipitation. Fridays, we'll see a lot of moisture stream in up out of the south. It's going to bring temperatures up into the 80s. Saturday, of course, the day that everybody's watching. Kim has asked me, Bob has asked me, well, what's the deal? Are we going to see showers throughout the day? And the answer to that, quite simply, is no. We will see some early showers. Let's take it and break it down for you hour by hour via the forecast model. Notice here as we move through Friday, 2:30, you can see the timestamp in the top right of the screen there, 9 a.m. We'll see an increase in cloud cover as we go into late Friday. Perhaps a few spot showers, maybe a rumble of thunder as some showers break away from the line, but the line itself likely won't roll through here until early Saturday morning. Here's 1 a.m. We'll start to see shower activity start in places like Whiteville, perhaps Shallotte, and as it moves across Brunswick County, some gusty conditions expected with the passing of this. And as we head into the late afternoon hours, we'll see the potential at least for shower activity here until about 1, perhaps maybe even 2 o'clock as that secondary line comes through, but then conditions will start to improve. Daytime high temperatures, of course, struggle. We only get up into the upper 60s for Saturday and Sunday. Then some warmer conditions move back into the forecast as we go early into next week.
Colin, all right, thanks very much. Continuing to keep an eye on the big fertilizer plant explosion down in Texas near Waco. Latest information, at least 5 to 15 people dead, 160 plus are injured. More as we continue on that and more news in just a moment. Carolina in the Morning will be right back.
First Alert Traffic is sponsored by the Law Offices of Richard Flexner. Serious accident or injury, get Flexner. We're serious.
Welcome back at 6:53, and the entire Carolina in the Morning team working hard to bring you the latest news you need to know as you start your Thursday morning.
Of course, following that big explosion down at the fertilizer plant in Texas, details on that in a moment. First to Caroline Waldrip and First Alert Traffic around the area, Caroline.
That's right. Well, the roads are open for you this morning. If you're about to head out to school or work, no delays to report. So let's go ahead and take a live look at the Cape Fear Memorial Bridge. If you're trying to head towards Leland right now, you should have no problems. If you're heading towards the downtown area, again, open roads, but just watch out for some patchy fog this morning. So be sure to put on those low beams as you get to where you need to be. And that's a look at your First Alert Traffic.
Good morning, I'm Lindsay Curtin, live here at Cape Fear Community College. You know, eat, sleep, sand, live it, love it. That's the life of a Cape Fear Community College boat building student. And this weekend, the fruits of their labor will be on display as these students have been spending all year building boats from start to finish. We're here in the paint room. You can see this finished product is looking great. If you'd like to check out these boats at this annual boat show, head to our website, WECT.com, for all the details.
And a look at the day's top stories. This morning, we're following that massive explosion and fire at a fertilizer plant in West Texas, about 80 miles from Dallas. The latest numbers we have for you this morning, at least 5 and anywhere up to 15 dead, more than 160 injured. There are also some firefighters reported missing. The explosion could be heard 45 miles away and sounded and felt like an earthquake. It has leveled many homes and buildings in a 4-block radius.
President Obama and the First Lady will be headed to Boston today to pay tribute to the victims of the Boston Marathon explosions. There's also some talk that authorities may have two suspects based on some surveillance videos, but Massachusetts Governor Deval Patrick saying the investigation will still take some time. Also this morning, at least 14 people remain in critical condition in Boston area hospitals.
Happening tonight, a free screening at Thalian Hall for the documentary Bully. It's a joint effort between law enforcement and school leaders to spread awareness of the negative impacts of bullying. The screening is open, but we did ask you to get tickets, and we're getting word that it may be sold out. For those of you who already have tickets, it's at 7 tonight at Thalian Hall.
Here we go again. Another perfect start to the day. Take a look outside. Ooh, right now.
That looks great.
Doesn't it look just awesome? gorgeous conditions here across eastern North Carolina. We're going to see those daytime high temperatures today move up into at least the upper 70s, if not even warmer than that. As we take a look at some of the current conditions here across the region, our high temperature today, again, several degrees warmer than what we have seen here, at least what we are seeing now. Temperatures up into the upper 70s again in Castle Hayne today. As we move back toward Wilmington, I think temperatures might just be a degree or two cooler at 78 degrees in Wilmington for your high temperature. Mostly sunny skies will continue throughout the day today as well. Look at the remainder of the forecast. We'll see those temperatures getting back up into the 80s for Friday, and then some rain chances start to move into the forecast as we head into your Saturday, mainly during the morning. I think this will clear out by the late afternoon. We'll have at least a day and a half of nice weekend weather with a thunderstorm threat diminishing as we go through the post-dawn hours as we head toward midday Saturday. And then cooler temperatures, 68 and 67 for both Saturday and Sunday, respectively. Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday around the corner and see temperatures warm up just a little bit more. So morning thunderstorms, afternoon clearing on your Saturday, sunny and cooler for Sunday afternoon.
Hey, Lorraine, help me not have to mow the yard this weekend.
Good, got your excuse out of the
way. Saturday morning.
Thanks for watching this morning. Stay tuned for the Today Show here on WECT. We're headed over to our sister station, Fox Wilmington. Go there for more local news and weather.